Still more doubts anyone have in first unit? And you people should be very aggressive in the class. You people should learn every day at least 1-1.5 hour. I request all my students to prepare their own short notes based on the day class. When the class got completed, immediately I want you people to write a short notes that what we have studied in the class, as well as what did you people feel it important topics are. Yeah, mostly I am going to start now. So welcome to the fluid mechanics session number 5. First 4 sessions we have completed unit number 1, that is properties of fluid. We have completed properties of fluid. Every student should study this unit. This will be the 2 marks weightage. 2 marks weightage unit will be properties of fluid. Yeah, moving on to the next topic. Today we are going into the new topic called as pressure measurement and hydrostatics. The name of the unit is pressure measurement. This is the first topic. Hydrostatics is the second topic. Most probably you may have a 1 mark question based on this unit. The weightage of this unit is 1 mark. Civil students and mechanical student, right? So coming to the first part of the subject called pressure measurement. Before going into pressure measurement, I want to know few fundamental things. Right? Yes, the students here, did you people see pressure anytime? Did you people see pressure anytime? Comment. Anyone in the class, did you people see pressure anytime? Are you comment yaar? No one saw pressure till now. Do you people know what is pressure? Am I audible? Am I audible? Hey, somebody respond, man. Yes. Okay. Ashwin, please give the answer, Ashwin. Anyone, did you people see pressure? What is pressure? When did you see pressure? Where did you see pressure? When did you people see pressure? Where did you people see pressure? Can anyone tell me? Force acting per unit area. Okay, what force, sir? Pressure can be felt or applied. Very good. Pressure can be felt. Pressure can be felt. Very good. Generally, pressure means normal force applied on unit area. Normal force applied on unit area. And it is always compressive in nature. It is always compressive in nature. Understood? Pressure, no, it's always normal force per unit area and it is compressive in nature. Right. Generally, when will you see pressure is when the fluid is at rest. Whenever the fluid is at rest, we will be seeing or we will be feeling or you will be calculating pressure. This pressure is always, this pressure is always caused due to, it is always caused due to weight of overlying fluid. Weight of overlying fluid. Weight of overlying fluid. What is this weight of overlying fluid? We are going to see in depth regarding this, right? Before this, I have a small doubt. What do you mean by stress? And what do you mean by pressure? What do you mean by stress? And what do you mean by pressure? Any difference? Any students, anyone finding it different, please comment. Generally, what is stress denoted by sigma and pressure denoted by P? Stress can be both tensile and compressive. Oh, is it? Then pressure can't be. Stress is also force per area, right? Units are Newton per meter square. Pressure is also force per area. Units are Newton per meter square. What is the difference here? Stress can be both. Stress is resistance. Internal resisting force acting per unit area is stress. Absolutely right answer. Geo, it is absolutely right. But why we are using two different terminologies, stress and pressure? Both have same empirical formulae. Both have same dimensions or units. Why two different words then? We can use stress in place of pressure or pressure in place of stress, right? Why always two different words? Stress need not be normal. Pressure is applied. Stress has direction. Pressure is always normal. Oh, okay. You people are, Sujit, you are talking about some directions. Please tell me, is stress scalar quantity or a vector quantity? Is stress a scalar quantity or a vector quantity? Tensor, tensor, why tensor? I'm asking you. Okay, what is pressure then? What is pressure then? Pressure is a scalar quantity. Lakshmi, vector, vector quantity is pressure or stress, ma? Scalar, pressure is scalar, stress is, few people are saying vector, few people are saying tensor. First of all, we'll talk about vector and scalar. Scalar means only magnitude. Only magnitude. It has no direction. Am I right? Vector will have both. Will have both magnitude and direction. Okay, now stress is a tensor quantity. Stress is a tensor quantity. Sometimes in strength of material, you also term it as vector quantity, because I'll be discussing you these things. Why pressure is a scalar quantity, right? See the diagram which is being shown to you here. This is some fluid body immersed. Okay, on this fluid, the pressure will be acting same in all the directions. One hero told this word. The name of the hero is Pascal. Pressure acting on the immersed body is equal in all the directions. So we can say 10 bar pressure is acting on the body. But where it is acting? Can you tell where 10 bar pressure is acting? No, never we can say that where it is acting. It is acting throughout the body, throughout the body. So pressure has only magnitude, no direction. So 110% pressure is a scalar quantity. So this is what, if anybody asks you, what is pressure? Pressure is a scalar quantity. Coming to stress, it may be sometimes tensor, it may be sometimes vector. For suppose, take a simply supported beam with point load at the center. Let it be A, B and C. 10 Newton force is acting. Where will the deformation be? At the middle. You will be drawing some deformations in this way, right? So you are showing that deformation is at this point C. For suppose in the same beam, if you take this load at an angle of 30 degrees, same 10 Newton, can you say that point D is having the deformation exactly? No. Here you can say maximum deformation is occurring here due to presence of force. You have force as well as direction. Magnitude and force is being shown. Whenever magnitude and direction of application is being shown, you call it as a vector quantity. Where only magnitude but no direction, we call it as a pressure. We call it as pressure. Any doubts? What is the difference between stress and pressure? Stress can be tensor or vector, but pressure is only scalar quantity always. Any doubt between stress and pressure? Please comment. If it is okay, I'll go to the next topic. Hope everyone understood. Can I go? Clear. Now, right. Note one point always you people need to remember. Always one point you people need to remember. Pressure depends on. Pressure depends on depth or height of the fluid. Depth or height of the fluid as well as specific weight. So here what does I mean to say is, irrespective to the shape of the container may be of any shape. Container may be of any shape, but pressure only depends on height. Pressure only depends on height, H. Irrespective to the shape of the container. Suppose this is the free surface of the body. Irrespective to the shape, it depends on height. Here also, if the body is of same height, this is the free surface. All the three different shapes have same height here. Let this be H1, let this be H2, let this be H3. H1 is equal to H2 is equal to H3. Different shape. Hydrostatic paradox. Yes, we are going to learn that in the next couple of minutes. H1 equal to H2 is equal to H3. See, here, irrespective to the shape of the container, pressure is independent to shape of the container. Please remember this point for a couple of minutes. I'm going to prove why. Okay. So this is the basic note and an important point to be remembered. Pressure depends on depth or height of the fluid or specific weight, not at all on the shape of the container. So based on this, this is clear, right? Based on this, I'm going to see how the pressure is validated. Now, right. Now, let us consider a single layered fluid. Single layered fluid. Single layered fluid. What does the single layered fluid mean is? Let us consider a tank. This is the free surface of the tank. Fluid is filled inside this tank. Single layered fluid is totally the tank is filled with only one layer. The height here is H. This is the point A. This is the point B. Now I want what is the pressure at point A and what is the pressure at point B. Can anyone tell me this is a single layered fluid? This is totally same fluid. Let it be water. What is the pressure at point A? Anyone answer, please. What is the pressure at point A? Pressure at PA is how much? Zero. Oho. Okay. Anything else? Local atmospheric pressure. Atmospheric pressure. Okay. As of some people are saying atmospheric pressure, or some people are saying zero. I don't have a clarity on this. We need to get the clarity on this based on the next progress of the subject. Okay. Yeah. Akhil, Vivek, Sujit, everyone are saying atmospheric pressure. Lakshmi, pressure at B is density into G into H. Okay. We need to add pressure A or not. So I have a small doubt in it. By the end of this lecture, we need to clarify this doubt. Okay, hold on with this. I'm remembering this. By the end of the lecture, we will be getting the clarity. What is pressure at B? Pressure at point B. Lakshmi told rho G H. Okay, but priorly I told you that weight of overlying fluid will cause the weight of overlying fluid will cause the pressure, right? At point B, will point A pressure will be acting or not? At point B, yes, it will be acting. So pressure at A. Is this the answer now? Okay. So we have a doubt now. Shall I add PA? If PA is zero, here I'll keep zero. If PA is some atmospheric pressure, I need to keep some value of atmospheric pressure, whatever it is, right? This is regarding the single layered fluid. Now I'm talking about multi-layered fluid. In a single layered fluid, I have a small doubt. What happens to pressure PA? B, rho g h, gauge pressure. Do you mean this is gauge pressure? First of all, I don't know what is gauge pressure or what is some other pressure. Please wait. I need to get clarified with that. Okay. Multi-layered fluid. Multi-layered fluid. This is point A, this is point B, this is point C. Here it consists of water. Here mercury. Let this height be H2. This height as H1, right? अगेन द सेम क्वेश्चन, व्हाट इज पीए, व्हाट इज पीबी, व्हाट इज पीसी, दैट इज प्रेशर एट थ्री पॉइंट्स। अगेन जीरो और एटमॉस्फेरिक, यू पीपल से पीबी, पीबी इज दिस, पीए प्लस रो जी एच ऑफ व्हाट, वॉटर। एन हम्बल रिक्वेस्ट, वॉट यू पीपल शुड रिमेंबर हियर इज डेंसिटी ऑफ वॉटर टू बी टेकन, हाइट ऑफ सबसिक्वेंट फ्लूइड शुड ओनली बी टेकन, नॉट द हाइट ऑफ द कंटेनर और हाइट ऑफ सम टोटल हाइट ऑफ द कंटेनर और हाइट ऑफ मिक्सिंग ऑफ फ्लूइड एक्सेट्रा। द हम्बल रिक्वेस्ट हियर इज ओनली हाइट ऑफ वॉटर एंड डेंसिटी ऑफ वॉटर शुड बी टेकन। When coming to PC, you people say PA plus rho G H1, this is H1 here, plus rho G H2. Many of the students, what I see is they take this rho common and this G common. Okay, G you can take it as common, but rho cannot be taken as common. If you take rho common, total sum goes wrong. This is density of water. This is density of mercury, which has a very drastic difference. So whenever you talk about pressure at point C, rho of the subsequent fluid which is having a height h should be taken. Whatever the height you are taking, that density only should be taken. Don't mix up the densities. Few students add rho 1 plus rho 2 is equal to rho. No, never do that. Subsequent height, subsequent density should be taken into consideration. So, by seeing these two, I have a doubt on what is pressure at A, atmospheric pressure or zero. That doubt to be clarified. So, hope you people understood till here. Hope you people understood till here about PA, we will be talking. Coming to the next point, what do you mean by classification of pressure? How is pressure classified into? How is pressure classified into? Pressure is mostly classified into atmospheric pressure, gauge pressure, and absolute pressure. And absolute pressure, atmospheric pressure, gauge pressure, and absolute pressure. Right. Most probably, you people are seeing atmospheric pressure or feeling atmospheric pressure. Am I right? You people are seeing atmospheric pressure or feeling atmospheric pressure, and you people are very happy with atmospheric pressure. No human body is getting affected with atmospheric pressure. Anyone here are getting any issues with atmospheric pressure? Can comment. So, I don't want to talk more about atmospheric pressure. Atmospheric pressure, simply what I conclude is pressure which is present around us. Pressure which is present around us, that is atmospheric pressure. We are in atmospheric pressure at this second also. It is not creating any nonsense. The pressure present around us is atmospheric pressure. Coming to gauge pressure, we have two types of gauge pressures. One is positive gauge pressure, then other one is negative gauge pressure or vacuum pressure or suction pressure or suction pressure. Negative pressures are called as vacuum pressure, suction pressures, and positive pressures are this. Why will I call it as gauge pressure? Why should I call it as gauge pressure? Why not with any other name? We use some devices. We use some devices called as pressure gauges. We use some devices called as प्रेशर गेजेस फॉर द मेजरिंग ऑफ दिस प्रेशर्स. व्हाट गेजेस यू यूज? वी हैव मल्टीपल गेजेस. वी मे हैव मैनोमीटर्स, वी मे हैव पीजोमीटर्स, वी मे हैव बोर्डन प्रेशर गेजेस, ट्रांसड्यूसर्स एक्सेट्रा. वाई शुड वी यूज अ डिवाइस? वाई शुड बी वी यूज अ डिवाइस? बिकॉज इट विल क्रिएट, दिस प्रेशर्स विल क्रिएट सम प्रॉब्लम टू द ह्यूमन बॉडी. दैट इज इफ द प्रेशर इज अबोव योर एटमोस्फेरिक प्रेशर, प्रेशर इज अबोव योर एटमोस्फेरिक प्रेशर, वी कॉल इट एज पॉजिटिव गेज प्रेशर्स. इफ द प्रेशर इज अबोव द एटमोस्फेरिक प्रेशर, यू कॉल इट एज पॉजिटिव प्रेशर्स. इफ द सेम प्रेशर इज लेस देन एटमोस्फेरिक प्रेशर, लेस देन एटमोस्फेरिक प्रेशर, वी कॉल इट एज नेगेटिव प्रेशर्स. होप अ ह्यूमन बॉडी कैन नॉट रेसिस्ट ए पॉजिटिव प्रेशर नॉर ए नेगेटिव प्रेशर. यू शुड ऑलवेज हैव ए atmospheric pressure. If the pressure is more on your body, you cannot tolerate. If the pressure is less on the body, you cannot tolerate. Then how we are knowing that it is, how we are knowing it is a pressure is more or less? By using these gauges, we will be finding out the pressure. So gauge pressure, can I say the reference to gauge pressure, reference to gauge pressure or a reference line to gauge pressure is atmospheric pressure? Reference to gauge pressure is atmospheric pressure. So when will we call it as gauge pressure? Any pressure above or below atmospheric pressure is called as gauge pressure. The reference for gauge pressure, reference for gauge pressure is atmospheric pressure. If any pressures which is less or more than atmospheric pressure is known as gauge pressure. And these gauge pressures are used by or measured by using a devices called gauges. These are many type of gauges like mechanical gauges, electrical gauges, etc. By using some instrument, if you measure your pressure, you call it as a gauge pressure. Whenever you want to measure gauge pressure, atmospheric pressure should be taken into criteria. So this is what about the gauge pressure. Any doubt still gauge pressure? Students, any doubt in gauge pressure? There are totally three types of pressure. One is atmospheric pressure, other one is gauge pressure. In this gauge pressure, we have two different types, positive gauge and negative gauge. Next, coming to absolute pressure. Absolute pressure. Absolute pressure. Absolute pressure is nothing but pressure measured from or with respect to zero pressure line. With respect to zero pressure line. Okay. Generally, how we give the absolute pressure is atmospheric pressure plus or minus gauge pressure. Why I am writing plus or minus? Because gauge pressure may be positive, may be negative. We don't know. Depending on that, the gauge pressure given here, we may get positive absolute pressure or negative absolute pressure. That depends on the gauge pressure. So any pressure measured from zero pressure line, you call it as absolute pressure. So when I represent it on a chart, this is called as zero pressure line. Zero pressure line. The bottom reference plane here is called zero pressure line. Somewhere this line we refer it as atmospheric pressure. We refer it as atmospheric pressure. What I told you, any pressure above or below atmospheric pressure, for suppose till this point you have some pressure, this is called as gauge pressure. Above atmospheric pressure is always positive gauge pressure. Below atmospheric pressure, any pressure till here, you call it as negative atmospheric pressure or vacuum pressure. Below atmospheric pressure is negative pressure. Above atmospheric pressure is positive pressure. And when will you call it as absolute pressure? We call it as absolute pressure when pressure measured from zero pressure line to gauge pressure, this you call it as absolute pressure. This is positive absolute pressure. This is positive absolute pressure. Your absolute pressure can also be this one, measured from zero line. Okay, so here we are measuring the positive gauge pressure. What happens if you measure till this point only, from zero pressure to that negative pressure, we called vacuum absolute pressure. We call vacuum absolute pressure. See, this is positive one, this is negative one. So there are, this is how a graph is represented to show a positive gauge pressure or a negative gauge pressure or an absolute pressure. If this is this is atmospheric pressure, below this we call it as negative gauge pressure. Above this, we call it as positive gauge pressure. This is negative gauge. This is positive gauge. This is how the different classification of pressures are being done. So in this diagram, we can show all the three things. This zone is a very safer zone for everyone. That is an atmospheric pressure zone. This zone is a very perfect zone. Here there will be no issues about temperature or pressure. This pressure, atmospheric pressure, is comfortable for our bodies without any disturbances. If you go here or if you come here, both the things causes some differences and which your body cannot sustain. Okay, this is about the classification of pressure. Any doubts till classification of pressure to anyone? Any doubts? Okay, so nice. Okay, so this is about the classification of pressure. Pressure is normal force acting per unit area, which is given as which has been always acting in the normal direction. And there are three different classifications which we have seen: gauge, absolute and atmospheric. Right. Now we are talking about something called as Pascal's law. What is Pascal's law? What is Pascal's law? Pascal's law, he says that pressure acting on the fluid element is equal in all directions. Fluid element is equal in all directions. Okay. And one more thing I'm telling you, Pascal's law, always the fluid should be immersed. Okay, this fluid element should always be immersed. If it is in the air, we can't say anything. According to Pascal's law, pressure acting on the fluid element immersed is equal in all the directions. Now, The question is, one thing always what we need to remember in case of pressure is, we know that if this is the diagram, see the diagram which has been given to you here, Z, X and Y, that is pressure acting in X direction will be equal to Y direction equal to Z direction will be P. Now, one thing always you need to remember in case of pressure is, whenever the body is in static condition, whenever the body is in static condition, what happens? We will never have a shear stress. Shear stress is zero, but there will be always a normal stress acting. It cannot be equal to zero. This is a basic thing or basic point to be remembered in case of pressure. In pressure, shear stresses will be zero because the fluid will be in rest condition and the sigma, that is normal stress, will be acting on the pressure, on the element. So it has equal stresses. From this point, we can say sigma X is equal to sigma Y equal to sigma Z. That is, stresses are acting in all the directions and that stress will be always same in all the direction. This point is to be remembered. This point is to be remembered. What happens when you take a three-dimensional hydrostatic element also? For suppose, if you take any three-dimensional hydrostatic element, if you take any three-dimensional hydrostatic element where stresses are acting on this element, sigma Z, sigma X and sigma Y in this direction, okay, sigma Y. In this direction also, we can say X is equal to Y equal to Z equal to sigma, as well as shear stress at any plane. It may be XY plane, YZ plane or XZ plane will be zero. Never ever pressure as a shear stress. It will be is equal to zero. A very important point you people should always remember. Static elements have equal normal stresses. This is the condition. Static elements have equal normal stresses. Now, for what kind of fluids Pascal's law is valid? For what kind of fluids Pascal's law is valid? Yes, anyone can tell me this answer. For what type of fluids Pascal's law is valid? Is it validated for ideal fluids or real fluids? Pascal's law is valid for ideal fluids or real fluids? Real also. How? Real fluids also. How? Ideal fluids, yes, no need to talk. This shear stress will be zero for ideal fluids. So Pascal's law is valid. Law is valid. Whereas for real fluids, tau is equal to mu into du by dy. When fluids are going in a uniform motion, when fluids are moving in the uniform motion, what happens to this du by dy? Velocity gradient becomes, yeah, it is, first of all the fluids at rest, it is validated. It is validated for all the fluids at rest, static fluids, which are ideal fluids, or real fluids, which are in static. Obviously, Pascal's law is valid. Pascal's law is also valid for real fluids in motion. It is valid for real fluids in motion. Why it is valid? Because whenever velocity gradient, this is having a uniform motion, du by dy, velocity gradient will be constant. constant multiplied with your viscosity is constant, and finally shear stress will be constant, tau. So Pascal's law can be validated. Pascal's law can be valid for fluids at rest, fluid at rest, as well as real fluids in uniform motion. So Pascal's law can be applied for both real fluids and ideal fluids at rest, and also real fluids in motion when it is having a uniform motion. Any doubts about the Pascal's law? By this point we are completing a term called pressure. A term pressure got completed. What is pressure, how pressure is acting, and what are the classifications of pressure? Right, clear. So this is about the Pascal's law. Anybody asks you where is Pascal's law applied? Pascal's law is applied for both fluids at rest as well as in motion, real fluids as well as ideal fluids, when the fluid motion is uniform. Okay, now I want to discuss about units of pressure. Units of pressure. Generally, pressure is measured in Newton per meter square, called as Pascal, bar, mm of Hg, meter of water, tor, right? Anything else you have? So anything else you have to listen, or anything else? Dyne per centimeter square. Okay. See, whatever it is, CGS, or this will be the thing what you have told in CGS units. Anything? PSI. Very good. PSI. What is the full form of PSI? Pound per square inch. Pound per square inch. These are the units. Or yeah, you can take your SI units, CGS units as dyne per centimeter square also. When you go to lab, your pressure gauges have kg force per centimeter square, this only. Right? Very good, Lakshmi. You will be seeing in your pressure gauges. Yeah. So this is about the units of pressure. You have these many units of pressure, but we mostly use bar or Pascal. When we talk about the conversion, 1 bar is equal to 10 power 5 Pascal. 1 bar is equal to 10 power 5 Pascal. 1 tor is equal to 1 mm of Hg. 1 tor is equal to 1 mm of Hg. These are the two things which you people should remember about the conversions. These are the conversions of units of pressure. Now we are going to see units of atmospheric pressure. Units of atmospheric pressure. Units of atmospheric pressure. First we call it as 1 atmosphere, right? Or this can also be termed as 1.01325. What is this? Bar. Very good. Bar. Or we can call it as 1.01325 into 10 power 5 Pascal. 1.01325 × 10⁵ pascal, that is nothing but newton per meter square. That is nothing but newton per meter square. We also call it as 760 mm of Hg. We can also find in water column height. Very good. It can be expressed in mercury column or air column, or 10.3 meter of water. 10.3 meter of water or 760 torr. Or 760 torr. 10.3 meter. Yeah, it is 10.3 or 76 centimeter of Hg. These are nothing but water column or as mercury column. It can be measured in any of the columns. Now my doubt is, why should atmospheric pressure be this much only? Why not some other value? Why does atmospheric pressure should have that value only? Why should atmospheric pressure? What is the standard condition, do you know? At zero sea level, at 15 degrees centigrade, taken value is one atmosphere. You go somewhere to Shimla. At this point, you are in Shimla. You cannot expect Shimla will have the same atmospheric pressure. No, atmospheric pressure is not everywhere. Yes, at zero sea level, at 15 degrees centigrade, you are taking it as one atmosphere. The value of it is 1.01325 × 10⁵ pascal. This is the condition. It need not be same at your house and my house, where depending on the situations, it will be changing. So this to be always known to you people. And 1 kilopascal means 10³ N/m². 1 megapascal mean 10⁶ N/m². 1 gigapascal mean 10⁹ N/m². And I told you 1 bar is 10⁵ N/m². Should be remembered with this conversions. He may confuse you with any of the value. And this atmospheric pressure can also be taken as 101.325 kilopascals. Most of the students I see in gate exams, they do wrong when the sum comes from pressure measurement or manometry. The only mistake what they commit is they commit in conversions. So that's why I am giving you in detail conversions. These are to be known. And you people told me something called 1 PSI, that is pound per square inch. How will you convert it into atmosphere? 1/14.7 atm is PSI. 1 pound per square inch. Generally, you see this PSI values of vehicles. The front tire of your vehicle will be 35 PSI and the rear tire will be 40 PSI. A front tire and rear tire, if you are riding a vehicle, when you take it for air filling, you will be knowing 35 PSI and 40 PSI. That are the standard PSIs for a two-wheeler, for front wheel and a rear wheel. This PSI is generally very rarely used units are PSI units, 35 and 40 units. Any doubts? Any doubts? Regarding the units. Okay. Now, one more doubt what I have here is, when I draw more circle, for pressure, what type of diagram we will be getting? When I draw a more circle, what type of diagram we will be getting? A point away from the axis. The diagram will be only a point on negative axis. Very good. Point on a negative axis, that is away from the center. Why? Because we have sigma x equal to sigma y equal to sigma, and this will always be in compression, right? Always compression. And what about shear stress tau xy? Shear stress tau xy will be zero. So when I consider an element, the shear stress tau xy will be acting. This will be sigma y, sigma x. This is the element which we will be drawing. For this, if I take the radius r, what formula I will be having? Sigma x minus sigma y by 2 whole square plus tau xy whole square. This will be the radius, and center will be around sigma x plus sigma y by 2 comma 0. This is regarding the radius and center. If I substitute the values, r is equal to minus sigma, minus of minus sigma by 2 whole square minus 0 square. The value which I'll be getting here is 0. The value which I'll be getting here is 0. Whereas if I take center and substitute here, which I'll be getting is minus sigma, minus of minus plus, once again, this is sigma plus of minus sigma by 2 comma 0. Minus minus, that will be minus 2 sigma by 2. That is minus sigma. The answer which we will be getting is minus sigma. When you draw the Mohr circle, this will be shear stress tau. This is sigma. Sigma, 2 sigma, 0, minus sigma, minus 2 sigma. Now we will be getting a point which should be on. This is the answer. That will be a point. Negative sign always shows compression. So this is an interview question, or it can be asked for 1 mark in an exams like IES or all state board examinations, common examinations, that how will Mohr's diagram or Mohr circle look for pressure. You should be always an answer as point on the negative axis, right? This is regarding the Mohr circle. Any doubts you have till now? Mohr circle, if anyone want to copy it, can copy the formulae and draw the diagram. Can I wipe off the screen? Can we go for other concept now? Yes, okay, done, Sujit. Next, we are coming to an important topic called hydrostatic law, right? What is hydrostatic law? One second, keep this concept aside for a few seconds. I have small doubt which you people should clear, right? I am standing at some place. This is atmospheric pressure. Okay. A basic hydrostatic law, what I know is P is equal to rho GH. Am I correct or wrong? Basic hydrostatic law, what I know is P is equal to rho GH. Is this correct or wrong? Anyone, please, if I am wrong, please correct me. Sujit, S, Geo dp by dz is equal to rho g. Whatever it is, z has gone up, man. P equal to rho gh. A simplified version. Okay. Now my question is, I am having some object called A here on the atmospheric pressure line. Okay. Now, what this is the point A. What I am doing is, I am making this point A move upward. I am going to a certain point. I am increasing the height of this point A. This is the object. This is the object. Okay. This point or this object, I am taking it to this point. This is height H. That means I am increasing the height. Increasing the height. What happens to the pressure? From here I can clearly say P is directly proportional to H. P is directly proportional to H. If this formula is right, P is directly proportional to H. So all the students should answer. Your friends are saying decreasing. Sujit and Geo. Yeah. See, pressure is directly proportional to H. As the height is increasing, pressure should increase. Or else, same A, I am bringing it down. Here, at this point, we have this particle A. Now, what happens to A1? The first position is A. This is A dash. This is A1. What happens to the pressure of the object at A1? Increases. I guess you people are telling in the reverse direction, no? What answer you people are saying is this. A dash decreases, A1 increases. Rest other students, I need an answer. Why you people are not answering? The answer for the question asked to you. Yes, other students also should reply. Be active in the class. Where did this Lakshmi give the answer? Akhil Krishna, Ashwin, you people didn't understand, sir. Then you need to ask it. Now, once again, actually it's ZH. Sujit, one second, please wait. A1 decreases or A dash, Ashwin. Lakshmi, see here, is this the hydrostatic law which you told at the starting of the class? P equal to rho gh. Yes. My question was like, this is the atmospheric pressure. I'm standing here. Okay. I'm catching one object called A. What I do is, I'm raising the height of the object. The new position is A dash. Okay. The height of the object, I'm increasing it. I'm going above the liquid surface. Geo, wait one second. I'm going above the atmospheric surface. This is the earth surface which I'm standing. I'm taking it higher and higher. My question is, what happens to this A dash? The object, when it is in A dash, does the pressure increase or decrease? Decrease. Oh, P is directly proportional to H now. Mr. Ashwin, there should be a gap between A and dash. You are spelling it in some other way. P is directly proportional to H. So The question again, Lakshmi, are you clear with the concept now? The same way I am getting it down. Density is dependent to height. There is the height of the column of air. As we go upward, volume of air above the body decreases. Yeah, guys, I'll talk about all the comments here. Please wait. One student who asked that she is not clear. I want to clarify her doubt first. Yes, Lakshmi, are you clear now? When you took A dash to this point, you told pressure is decreasing. The same thing I wrote here. Pressure decreases at A dash. When we are taking this body down, okay, to A1, you people said pressure is increasing. This is absolutely correct answer. Absolutely correct. See, this H does not represent the height. H represents the depth from free surface. Depth represents, sorry, H represents depth from free surface. Yeah, I'll talk about density also. Wait, depth from the free surface should increase. The result should be dp by dh should be rho g. Yeah, thank you, Lakshmi. Dp by dh should be equal to rho g. Whenever you are calling it as a height, the height should be coming in the downward direction from the free surface. If it is going in the upward direction, you need to say altitude is increasing. Altitude is increasing. When altitude increases, pressure decreases. When altitude increases, pressure decreases. What do you mean by altitude? This is your atmospheric pressure. Going above the atmospheric pressure is called as altitude. Now, coming below, this is the height or depth, whatever you think P equal to rho gh is. This height or depth, generally we should term it as depth. As depth is getting increased, pressure should increase. Pressure should increase. This is the concept what I need to tell you people is. So, as altitude increases, pressure decreases. When depth increases, pressure increases. This is the note point which you all people should remember. This is given by hydrostatic law. We will be deriving this equation now. Understood, right? So if anyone asks you this, you need to give the appropriate answer in this way. Right, hydrostatic law states that pressure at any point in the fluid at rest, or I'm writing in a very shortcut manner here, rate of increase of pressure in vertically downward direction, in vertically downward direction must be equal to specific rate of increase of pressure in vertically downward direction. Must be equal to specific weight of the fluid at that point. This is the definition of hydrostatic law. Now We are going to derive this hydrostatic law, that is P equal to rho gh. considering small cylindrical element of height dh, the height is dh. At one end, a pressure is acting on the small surface area of dA, and other end P plus dP dA, and the weight is acting downward. The weight of the molecule, weight of the fluid particle is acting downward. Here, the first point what I want to tell you is pressure force on the upper face. Pressure force on upper face is equal to PdA, acting in vertically downward direction. Okay, and it will always act perpendicularly only. Next, on the lower face, it is P plus dPdA. On the lower face, it is P plus dPdA, which is always acting in the vertically upward direction. This is in the vertically downward direction. Now, and this is the figure what I have drawn it. This is the actual figure. The weight force will be acting downward. Okay. PdA from the top, P plus dPdA from the bottom, height is dH, weight force is acting in the downward direction. For equilibrium of the element. Equilibrium of element. Keep this body in equilibrium. It will be PdA, that is a forces which are coming from top, plus W. W, I am writing it as mg, right, is equal to P plus dPdA. This is the condition for making the body in equilibrium. PdA plus density into volume into g. Can I write mass as density into volume is equal to PdA plus dPdA. Density into volume. Volume is dA into dH. Small volume. Can I write like this? dA into dH is equal to dPdA. I forgot to write g here. I'm writing it at the starting. Okay. Now, dP by dH is equal to rho g. This is called as hydrostatic law, or we can write it as dP by dH is equal to omega, specific weight. This hydrostatic law gives variation of pressure. This gives variation of pressure. Variation of pressure in vertical direction. In vertical direction. We need to spell hydrostatic law like this only. This is the proper way to spell it. Okay. That is, change in pressure with respect to height should be equal to omega. If you have any doubts, if H is taken in vertically downward direction, if H you are taking in vertically downward direction, for easy analysis, you keep dP by dH is equal to minus omega. Always this negative sign represents the depth is getting increased. So this is regarding the hydrostatic law. This is called as hydrostatic law. dP by dH is equal to omega. Or if you are going downward, you will be taking it as minus omega. That is only for the remembrance. Minus does not play a very important role, which will only give you the reference with respect to free surface. You are coming up or going down. So this is the value of hydrostatic law. Any doubts in the derivation of hydrostatic law? This derivation is important for IES descriptive paper. The derivations which I am giving for the derivation which I am solving in the class are important for IES. There are 12 to 13 derivations in the total fluid mechanics where you will be asked as a 5 marks question sometime in the descriptive paper of ESC examination. This question will be asked many times. So that's why I gave you the derivation here. Okay, can I move on to next slide? I'll be sending you the notes of this derivation. No need to worry. If you can take a screenshot, take a screenshot. That's it. Can I move on? Right. So now we are taking one case like pressure at any depth h. Pressure at any depth h. Now, this is the free surface. From here, we are coming with some height of h. On this free surface, the atmospheric pressure will be acting in the normal direction, P atmosphere. So we know that h is equal to zero at free surface. H equal to zero at free surface. P is equal to P atmosphere. This also I know because on the free surface, atmospheric pressure will be acting. My formula is dP by dH is equal to omega. dP is equal to omega into dH. Here, integrating on the both sides, we get integrated. Integrating, we get P is equal to omega H plus C. Let it be equation one. We are getting P equal to omega H plus C. Now substitute the values. In place of P, I need to substitute P ATM omega into H is 0 plus C. So C becomes P atmosphere. C becomes P atmosphere. Now substitute this C in equation 1. That is P is equal to omega H plus P atmosphere. Now what is this P? The total absolute pressure, if I get P equal to omega H plus P atmosphere, what happens to gauge pressure? For gauge pressure, P atmosphere, what we will be taking as P atmosphere for gauge pressure? As zero. I told you I will be clarifying one doubt for single layer fluid and multi-layer fluid here. See, P atmosphere is zero or atmospheric pressure. We had a small doubt here. For that, see, whenever we are talking about gauge pressure, I told you one point, reference is always atmospheric pressure. Reference is a datum line. Datum line pressure will be always zero. At the datum line, pressure will be always zero. So atmospheric pressure is taken as zero. This is the point. Now, when you are talking about atmospheric pressure, the basic reference line is gauge pressure. Whenever you are talking about gauge pressure, the basic reference you will be taking datum as atmosphere, and this atmospheric pressure should be zero. So P is equal to omega H plus atmospheric pressure is zero. From this equation, I'm substituting atmospheric pressure as zero. So what happens? P is equal to rho g h. This is how we can conclude that P is equal to rho g h, where pressure, P is the pressure, h is the height of the point from free surface. Height of the point from free surface means I took in this diagram. See, this is the height from the free surface. What I term here is depth. Here, that is the value. So P equal to rho gh, we got it in this way. Any doubts you have till now? P equal to rho gh is the derivation of this by taking gauge pressure, atmospheric pressure as zero or datum. If you don't want to talk about rho gh, talk about dP by dH is equal to omega. This is the hydrostatic law. Both the derivations I have shown you. dP by dH equal to omega. Whenever you want to write it as P equal to rho gh, why I got P equal to rho gh on the free surface also we have seen. Any doubts till now? Any doubts can comment. Hydrostatic law is very important. Heart of pressure measurement is hydrostatic law. If you people didn't get hydrostatic law, the next topic won't be understood for you people. You won't even have a basic idea also if you are not understanding the hydrostatic law. किरण क्लियर। राइट, एवरीवन इज क्लियर? इफ प्लीज गिव मी अ कमेंट और एनी डाउट्स यू कैन आस्क मी। वी आर गोइंग इनटू द डीपर पॉइंट्स ऑफ द सब्जेक्ट नाउ। ओके, होमवर्क फॉर यू पीपल इज, होमवर्क फॉर यू पीपल टुडे इज, आई वांट हाउ मच मीटर ऑफ वाटर वी विल बी मेजरिंग द प्रेशर। आई वांट द कैलकुलेशन। वी नो दैट इट इज 10.3 मीटर ऑफ वाटर। आई वांट टू नो हाउ दिस 10.3 मीटर हैज केम। होमवर्क टुडे इज हाउ दिस 10.3 मीटर हैज केम। एंड एचएम ऑफ मर्क्यूरी यू पीपल टोल्ड मी 760 mm ऑफ एचजी। आई वांट द कैलकुलेशन हाउ यू गॉट 760 mm ऑफ एचजी। I want the calculation of you got 760 mm of Hg, okay, and HM of oil. HM of oil takes specific gravity as 0.8 for this oil. This is the homework questions, okay? These are homework questions. HM of water is 10.3 meter of water. Yeah, I understood. I want to know how I got these values. There are any calculations. For mercury also, how much you will be get for oil of specific gravity 0.8. I want how you people will get the answer as. Okay, these three you people should do it by the next class. Done. So next, I'm going on to the next topic now. Measuring instruments. Shall I move on? No doubts to anyone till now. Good. Next is pressure measuring instruments. How do you measure pressure? Can anyone tell me, please? How do we measure pressure? Generally, we have mechanical gauges. Mechanical gauges to measure pressure. We have manometers to measure pressure. We have transducers to measure pressure. These are the three modes how you measure pressure. Generally, always any mode of measuring device will have a basic fundamental principle. Basic one fundamental principle you will be having. This mechanical gauges, we have mechanical gauges like Borden gauge and bellow gauges for the measurement of pressure. Next, when we talk about manometers, we will be using this manometers in all the equipments of your fluid mechanics and hydraulic machines lab. And these manometers are purely based on a principle called as hydrostatic law. Hydrostatic law. Am I right or wrong? And this manometers are classified into simple manometers as well as differential manometers. Simple manometers and differential manometers. Simple manometers are nothing but which are used to measure pressure at a particular point. Differential manometers are used to measure pressure between two points. between two points. These are the basic fundamental things of a manometers. Simple manometers are we talk about piezometer, and we also talk about simple U tube manometer. This differential manometers, you talk about differential U tube manometer. Inverted U tube manometer. As well as inclined manometer, and you have many other types, like you have tank type manometers, etc., etc., and you have micrometers. But for your gate and IES portion, most of the time we will be talking about these topics called as differential U tube, inverted manometers, inclined manometers, piezometers, and a U tube manometer. Now, before going into this pressure measuring devices, one doubt what I want to ask you people is, how could we forecast rainfall? When I switch on my TV and go to any news channel, they'll say next 3 days or 4 days we will be having a monsoon, we will be hitting with a heavy rain, etc., etc. How? No, humidity changes. In Kerala you may have one humidity, in Hyderabad I am having one humidity. Pressure drop on a certain region attracts rainy clouds. Oh my god, how, man? Partial answer is right, Mr. Akhil. Depth of rainfall, a new word, fuzzle. Akhil Krishna, your answer is partially correct. No need to leave the group. Okay, done. Lakshmi, humidity in atmosphere. Humidity, obviously, from one reason to other reason, it will be changing. That doesn't mean that water should, like rainfall should happen. Once you people are in Kerala, you feel cool. But I am in Hyderabad, I'm feeling a bit more moisture and high humid. That doesn't mean there is no rain from morning. How will, or any equipment will tell you that there will be a rainfall? You have any equipments? Yeah, you can guess the answers, no problem. If you are wrong also, no one are going to give you a cashback if you are right, or I won't take from you people if you are wrong. Come on, guess the answers, no problem. This was a question asked in a DRDO interview. That's why I'm asking you. How do you people, pressure difference causes movement of clouds? How will you find? And one more thing. Yeah, okay, the answer is good. And pressure drop makes wind to blow, which wind attracts clouds. No, I guess. See, and they'll be giving you exactly tomorrow at 7 p.m. or 10 p.m. or 5 p.m. You will have rain in this zone. Or in the next couple of 2 days, Chennai will have a drastic rainfall. They give in that way. How? And they'll say that the monsoon, the cyclone is going to hit this surface, and these zones may have a high rainfall. How? Generally, an instrument called barometer. An instrument called barometer is used to forecast the rainfall. What happens is, when a cyclone is formed, there will be sudden drop of level or a height raise, sudden drop of level in barometer. The sudden, that is, It should always be at a height of 760 mm of Hg, no? It should be at a height of 760 mm of Hg. This height suddenly falls to some 450, 430, 500 or 600. That represents a cyclonal effect. They say depression. They say depression. When this depression occurs, pressure will be decreased. When this pressure decreases, velocity will increase drastically, and from that zone the wind will be blowing with very high speed. Wind will be blowing at very high speed, and all the places we have a whenever we see this, we have some boat called north and south in this way, and this boat will be revolving according to the direction of the wind. So by taking out the satellite pictures there, you can clearly mention that where the depression is being formed. From that depression zone, the wind will be flowing out. We will be finding the velocity of the wind in meter per second. So that this wind, by seeing the direction, we can say that a zone of Chennai or a zone of some Kerala may hit this at particular time based on the velocity of wind. Based on the velocity of wind. So this is how they will be forecasting. Sometimes they give you a forecast that as suddenly there is a change in wind direction and cyclone has been changed to Bangladesh. It went to Bangladesh or Nepal. Suddenly it has changed the direction of wind direction has been changed and the cyclone has went somewhere. This all news you will be hearing most of the times. This all happens only due to this depression. When the depression is formed, pressure falls low, velocity of the wind increases, and as it is coming and hitting the shore, what happens? Pressure will be very, very less, and they say that winds will be blowing at 200 kilometers per hour, 150 kilometers per hour. Why? Because this is the analysis. Barometers are the devices which are used to find the cyclonal effect, and a sudden drop of level in barometers represents a cyclonal effect. This was a one mark question, one competitive examination, and most of the times in interviews they will be asking you, how will you find out the cyclonal effect? How do you forecast? Now also we use barometers only. Whenever you go to your laboratory, at one end you should have a barometer to see the pressure. I told you at the starting of the class, it doesn't mean that every place should have 760 mm of Hg. All places won't have this, or one atmosphere. I told you Shimla will have something, Jammu Kashmir will have something, Kashmir will have something. By zero sea level, the place where you have zero sea level at 15 degrees centigrade, you have that pressure, or else that pressure will be different. This is about the barometer. A very important instrument which you people should always remember is barometer. Barometer is the first device to find out all these things regarding pressure, right? Any doubts with barometer? Any doubts with barometer? Please comment. Most probably, I guess the time is 7 now. We will be concluding the class. Yeah, it's only any doubts? No doubts, Ashwin. Okay. Once check with clear. Yeah, once check with starting of the class. Any doubts you have, you can ask me. We have started with pressure measurement and hydrostatics. In the next class, I'll go with the pressure measuring devices called piezometers. Okay. We have spoke about pressure. Always pressure is a scalar quantity. It has magnitude and no direction. How the pressure will be changing. It will be changing based on the specific weight of the fluid and height. It is independent to shape of the container. Classification of pressures, atmospheric gauge and absolute. This is how the diagram which we show different types of pressure. Pascal's law, shear stress will be zero. Normal stresses only will be acting on the fluid element when it is in rest. This is Pascal's law. It will be validated for both ideal as well as real fluids in rest as well as in motion with uniform motion only. Units of pressure. Very important conversions are this. If you people are missing these conversions, again, it will be an issue while solving the problem. Okay. हाइड्रोस्टैटिक लॉ, दिस डेरिवेशन इज इंपॉर्टेंट, डीपी बाई डी एच इक्वल टू रोजी और डीपी बाई डी जेड इक्वल टू रोजी और डीपी बाई डी जेड वॉट एवर इट इज राइट. एंड प्रेशर मेजरिंग इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स टू टाइप्स वी नीड टू स्टडी, वी गो विद सिंपल मैनोमीटर्स एंड डिफरेंशियल मैनोमीटर्स इन डेप्थ इन द नेक्स्ट क्लास. सो वी विल बी स्टार्टिंग विद पीजोमीटर्स इन द नेक्स्ट क्लास. या
सर, अ स्मॉल डाउट सर.
या यू कैन
सर, यू सेड इन द बिगिनिंग इटसेल्फ दैट प्रेशर इज जस्ट नॉर्मल फोर्स बाय एरिया.
नॉर्मल फोर्स एक्टिंग पर यूनिट एरिया.
यस, ओके सर. एंड इट इज लाइक फोर्स इज ऑलवेज वेक्टर, बट एरिया कैन बी अ वेक्टर एज वेल एज अ स्केलर, नो राइट?
एरिया
कैन बी अ वेक्टर एज वेल एज अ स्केलर, नो सर. इफ इट इज, इफ द एरिया इज इनफिनिटेसिमली स्मॉल, I studied that area can be considered a vector.
See, unit area is this. For suppose this is the element where the pressure is acting. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, normal force. Now your doubt is area may be a vector or a scalar.
Yes.
Yeah. Area. See, once again, when we are taking this as an elemental area,
okay,
this will be very smaller. Elemental area is neglected area, right?
Yes.
Yeah, we define pressure when I'm talking it force applied on unit area means you one droplet of water you should take into consideration.
Okay,
not
sir.
Not the total plane you take. Okay, it will be acting in the normal direction, but on each and every particle. While we are deriving the hydrostatic law, also what we have done is we have taken a fluid element. This is.
Yes, okay, fine.
Yeah,
sir.
We need to consider element. That's why I'm doing it as DA, no?
Yes, yes, okay.
Yeah, yeah, that is the thing. Any more thing?
No.
Yeah. So, this is the hydrostatic law. So, please be prepared by this topic. In the next class, we are going with piezometer. And whoever contacts are with me in the WhatsApp, I'm going to send the material.